just tell them this, tell them neighbor, there is a God. You, I don't care how much faith you have in God, life has a way of bringing you to a place of doubt and fear. I'm trying to believe that God is going to work it out, but it seems like I'm running out of time. Seems like the fourth quarter now, the clock is ticking away, and it doesn't seem like that my victory has any probability. I shared even on last Sunday that there's a difference between probability and possibility.
Right.
You look at the probability of a thing, probability has to do with numbers and sense. It has to make sense to you, but you've got to know that even when things are not probable, that God's promise over your life is still possible. Cannot be done. You must understand by faith, 2 + 2 is not always going to equal 4. Your ducks are not always going to be lined up in a row. You're not going to always have the necessary resources and connections to see the promise of God come to pass. But even when it is not probable, you have to believe even that it is still possible. You must know that there are some who declare that there is no God, and they use the social circumstances to substantiate their claim. Because if there in fact was a God, why would there be hunger in the land? If in fact there was a God, why would sickness and disease run so rampant? If there is a God, why is murder at an all-time high? I would see the cry of Habakkuk. He said, it looks like the saints are suffering and the wicked are on the rise. And if you're not careful, it will bother you when you see your sinful neighbors getting promotions and getting new things while you're struggling just to maintain what you have. But the Bible teaches us, I hear David say, fret not thyself because of evildoers, and neither be thou envious because of the workers of iniquity. He said, for they shall soon be cut out. I don't know about you, I'm not interested in a quick blessing. I just want a lasting blessing. I don't have to get it quick, but I just want to know that when I get it, it's going to be mine. When you rest in God, you know that God is your protector. Let me tell you one other thing. When you walk in the will of God and the favor of God is on your life, you'll learn how to rest in God because you understand, except the Lord build the house. Bible said the laborer laboreth in vain. Because I have discovered that when the pressure mounts in your life, it is an opportunity for you to see the hand of God rise in your life. How would you know that God could do all that he has done except you've had an experience with him? I've discovered further that your testimony won't do for me what mine will. I thank God for what he has done for you. And I'll shout and I'll rejoice with you. But there's something about my own story that will push me to another level of faith and confidence in God. So now change your disposition regarding your trouble and your trial. Stop being frustrated. Get excited. Pump your chest and say, I know that if I can't handle it, my God is on the way. Look at your neighbor and tell him, he knows me. And he knows what I need. So before your pride is ever uttered, I want you to understand that God is already working on the answer to your prayer. So why would you fret? Why would you worry? You serve the kind of God who is conscious of your need before it shows up. Don't you know that God knew you were coming to this place before you ever got there? And I need you to understand that he's already prepared a way of escape. There is no temptation coming unto man that God has not already prepared a way of escape. Accept no invitations to pity parties. I don't accept invitations. When I see people, especially believers, walking around and looking sad and pouting because you want somebody to ask you what's wrong, I'm telling you now, I'm not going to ask you. Because I'm telling you now, the God that you serve has already prepared. And see, here's how you know that's what it is. Because even when you accept the invitation and you ask them what's wrong, and then when they tell you what's wrong, when they get through talking and you tell them, listen, the word of the Lord says thus, and the word of the Lord says this, God has promised to do that. And when you get through telling them what God has said, they still tell you, but I just don't know. Well, I'm going to give you this back because I have no interest in coming to this party. Yes, I've been under pressure, but the God that I serve, God, that he's not a respecter of person. What he's done for one, he'll do for the other. You must understand that your praise and your tongues don't get you ahead of the line. Sometimes folks will make you think that there having seniority in the kingdom of God because they speak in tongues and know 20 scriptures. I shared with a young lady yesterday. I said, listen, sweetheart, don't you ever be frustrated because church folk know 20 scriptures and you don't know but one. I said, it don't matter how many you quote, it matters how many you do. And if you know one, if you do that one, you will have the one that's quoted. Well, see, David had been in Saul's house and he had a glimpse of what Saul's daughter looked like. See, his brothers had never been in the house. So that's why they didn't understand what the cause was. And so when David showed up to the fight, and the first thing he says to them, is there not a cause? Now, Pastor, how does this translate? When you know what God has promised you, when you know what God has in your destiny, you look at people who are considering giving up and you tell them, oh yes, there is a cause because I have seen where God is taking me and I'm not going to let this situation make me give up on my expectation. Look, with every situation, you've got to have a revelation that will help you to hold on to your expectation. I'm not holding on because I'm thinking that God is going to do it. I'm not holding on because I'm hoping he's going to do it. I'm holding on because I know it's just a matter of time. But I want you to understand that I don't want to know what you're going through unless you can tell me that you're coming out. Because there is something about the believer that understands that going in, I'm coming out. Oh God, help me. I said, I understand going in, I'm coming out. So that means I can go in with a certain confidence. Yes, you may go in with tears in your eyes. You may go in with a headache and you'll go in with frustration, but you also go in with a confidence. And that confidence is of this very thing that he who hath begun a good work in me shall complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. What is the word adversity? It is when adverse or opposing forces come against your plan and your vision. You've got plans, you've got dreams, you've got things and goals that you're intending to accomplish. But it seems like contrary winds. You know the ones that were in Mark chapter 6. It seems like contrary winds are blowing against your dream. When it looks like contrary winds are blowing against your dream, elbow your neighbor, tell them keep on pushing. Because God will cause contrary winds to blow against you so that you can build up some kingdom stamina. Well, when the trouble comes, because if you faint in the day of adversity, it's only because your strength is small. So if my strength is small, how do I get big muscles? I got to deal with some more resistance. So the resistance that's coming against you is not going to destroy you. God's just trying to build you up in your most holy faith. He's trying to prepare you for what's on the way. This thing is not going to destroy you, but God's getting ready to push you. God said it was never going to be easy for you. He said, because you won't be different from others. Others have come out just with the victory. But God said, you will come out with the victory and a testimony. See, because it's one thing to have the victory and a testimony. Because the victory and the testimony prepares you for the next battle. I just remember like David did. David didn't call no fast. He didn't get on his knees and pray. But when he got to the mountain, he remembered the lion and the man. He said, at the same call, look at your neighbor and tell him, neighbor, the God that delivered you in 2002, the God that did in 2011, the God that did in June, July, and August, tell him it's the same God that's going to do it now. And I want you to understand that there are going to be constant threats against what you believe in God for. Don't you think that one church service is going to make the enemy behave? There are going to be constant threats. There are going to be constant opposition. Oh yes, there are going to be constant hindrances to what you believe in God for. That's why he said, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Because God is not unjust to forget your labor of love. He's watching your attitude. He's watching your reaction. Tell your neighbor, be careful. He's watching you. And whenever you had an experience with God, then your experience will produce expectation. But a lot of folk who are not spiritual. spiritual. They call it cockiness and arrogance. Lean on your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, I'm not cocky, neither arrogant. But tell them, I am confident. So it's because I've had an experience with God. And in my experience with God, he told me some things. He told me that the battle was not mine. He told me that the battle belonged to him. So the reason I'm standing here, like I'm standing here, because I already understand that I don't really have to fight this giant. All I got to do is stand. Get on your somebody say, there's a God. Don't let circumstances get you down. There is a God. Look at your neighbor. I'm going to stick with my G's now. Where's his name?